Stafford, Spotsylvania.
Fredericksburg.
There were no sightings here.
Culpepper. Yeah. Well, some people will show up at 7:15, but you know. We'll get started. Let's just go right in. Let's pray. And let's ask the Lord to be here with us. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much, Lord, for your spirit, Lord, that lives in us, Lord, that abides in us. Lord, we thank you that you are here among your people, Lord, that you're not a respecter of, Lord, persons. Lord, it doesn't matter how many. Lord, we thank you so much that you tell us to come boldly to your throne of grace. And Lord, we want to do that. Lord, we want to worship you. Lord, we want to praise you. We want to lift up your name in song. And Lord, we want to grow in our walks with you tonight. Lord, please let that be our heart's desire. Lord, to know more of who you are. Lord, as we read on Sunday, Lord, those prayers in Ephesians, and I believe in Colossians, Lord, just the eyes of our hearts being, Lord, opened, understanding more about who you are, Lord, growing in our understanding of you. Lord, please, we pray that you'd be lifted up as we worship right now. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys can stand. Thank you. You are good, you are good, when there's nothing good in me. You are love, on display for all to see. You are light, darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sin. Crippling, you are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, you death is lost in sting. And oh, I'm running to your eyes. Your arms, the riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. You are more, you are more than my words will ever say.
Sin, who knew no sin, that we might become
His righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah. Lord of all.
His body.
His body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out, all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Your love so is so great. Lord, we thank you for showing us, Lord, the greatest amount of humility. Lord, you are our example of being God, but Lord, being willing, Lord, to be submitted to sinful world, to go through things that are so terrible. But Lord, your love is so great. To the King who gave everything for me, whose body crucified high on Calvary Street, whose redemptive blood makes way for me, I now give everything. To the King who came in the form of a child, all-powerful God, and yet so mild, whose obedience shows the way for me, I humbly come to thee. To the King alone I will give my life, to the King I will sing both day and night. To the Lamb of God who has paid the price, to the King alone I will give my life.
To the King the one true royalty, the King he has befriended.
To the King alone I will give my life. To the King alone I will give my Lord, you've told us to present our bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable and blameless. Lord, because this is our reasonable service. Lord, it's what is it should not surprise us, Lord, that you require it of us. Lord, you want all of our hearts, our soul, our mind, our strength, but all of our being. Lord, we pray that you would help us, Lord, to live for you. Lord, to be faithful servants, Lord, to be good stewards of what you've given to us. Lord, that we would love you, Lord, that we would love your word, Lord, that we would love your people, Lord, that we would love your commands. Lord, we thank you so much for your spirit in our lives, Lord, the one who helps us, Lord, the one that enables us to live for you. And we thank you that you have not, Lord, left us here, Lord, to struggle and to fight on our own. But God, you've given us your spirit, Lord, and we have your power. And Lord, we can live, Lord, for you. God, we thank you so much. Lord, we love you, and we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good evening, small Gideon's army. I guess the tornado warnings and tornado watches scared everybody away tonight. I had wondered, I actually got a couple of emails, or at least one email, wondering whether we were going to cancel the service tonight because of that, but it seemed like the warnings weren't very long, so I didn't really see the point in it. But hopefully everybody's good and safe. I heard the hand chariots had I guess the warnings were worse out Culpeper area and stuff. So, anyway, tell you what, boy, when the Lord wants to shake things up with the weather, isn't that amazing how powerful God is? I was explaining that to Joseph tonight, how sometimes the Lord has to allow these weird weather patterns to disrupt our lives to help us to realize that... that we're not in control, you know? And it might seem like, well, why does God have to do that? Why doesn't he do it some other way, you know? Well, he does it a lot of different ways. But one of the most obvious ways, one that we have the least control over of all the things that could happen to us, is our health and the weather. We have no control over that. I mean, yeah, we might have control over our health if we take care of ourselves better than somebody else. But the weather, we have no control over that at all. The contrary to the global warming crowd, it doesn't matter what we do to try to spare the atmosphere. If the Lord wants to allow a tornado or a hurricane or an earthquake, there's nothing humanly we can do to prevent it. So the Lord allows these types of things to help us to realize that he is so above and beyond us, and we have to be reminded of that because of the proneness that we have to losing sight of God's power. You know, we start getting a little self-sufficient, start getting a little cocky. You know, man, I'm really doing well now. I've really taken care of myself. Man, I know how to provide for my family. Man, I know how to fix this, and boy, we're bunkered down, man. Think of all the preppers, you know, all the preppers that have put all that time and preparation into preparing for the apocalypse. And I'm not saying there's not some wisdom in that, but ultimately, our hope has to be in the Lord and nothing else. You guys know that, right? We're aware of that. So anyway, let's open up our Bibles to Jeremiah chapter 31. We're going to look at a great example of faith tonight. Jeremiah 31. Some of you may know that Carla and I are going to be heading out of town tomorrow. So we will appreciate your prayers that the Lord would keep us safe in our travels. In the meantime, we're here for the next number of hours anyway. And this is the greatest thing for me. I would rather do a Bible study than travel across the globe, to be honest with you. And so this is the greatest privilege for me to be able to have time in the Word, especially time together. We can spend time in the Word together. Well, this evening we're going to continue our journey through Jeremiah chapter 31. As we've already seen, this is a chapter filled with promises about what God has planned for the people of Israel. Now, we're not really going to backtrack very much at all, except to read through what we've already covered last week to set us up for what's ahead of us. So let's go ahead and pray together and just ask the Lord to bless our time. Amen. Amen. Lord, we thank you for so much that we have the Holy Spirit to guide our hearts into all truth. We thank you, Lord, that by the power of your Spirit, we can not only understand what you're saying to us through your word, but we also have the power to line up our lives, to be renewed in the spirit of our mind, and to line up our lives in accordance with your word. You've given us the capacity to obey your word. And Lord, you've blessed us with the ability to have a personal relationship with you. Lord, without you, we would perish. Whom have I in heaven but thee, and there is none on earth that I desire besides thee. And Lord, I pray that our desire would be to know you even more. And tonight, Lord, as we look into your word, I pray that we would be drawn closer to you. As we look at how you interacted with your people, and specifically Jeremiah, we pray, Father, that our hearts would be drawn to know you in a, perhaps in the same way Jeremiah did. And so, Lord, we ask that you would just bless our time in the word. Help me to be able to rightly divide the word of truth and give us open hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's read through what we covered last week, and then we'll move on from there. Verse 31. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not like the covenant which I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, my covenant which they broke, although I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. But this is the covenant which I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and on their heart I will write it, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And they will not teach again each man his neighbor and each man his brother, saying, know the Lord. For they will know me from the least of them to the greatest of them, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and their sin I will remember no more. Now, as we discussed 2 weeks ago, or last week, this glorious promise has two phases of fulfillment. The first being its fulfillment in the church, which initially began at the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 2. Hebrews chapters 8 and 10 informs us about the initial fulfillment taking place in the church, but its ultimate fulfillment will take place during the national restoration of Israel to their Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul said in Romans 11:25, I'll read this to you. He said, for I do not want you, brethren, to be uninformed of this mystery, so that you will not be wise in your own estimation, that a partial hardening has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And so all Israel will be saved. It's kind of weird to think about the fact that there is going to be like a last person who gets saved. Isn't that weird to think about that? Imagine knowing that going off into eternity. That was the last convert on planet Earth. Just as it is written, the deliverer will come from Zion. He will remove ungodliness from Jacob. This is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. Now, the theological viewpoint known as replacement theology, I don't know if you've ever heard of that before, but replacement theology essentially teaches that the church has replaced Israel in God's plan. Adherents of replacement theology believe that the Jews are no longer God's chosen people, and God does not have specific future plans for the nation of Israel. And so the prophecies in Scripture concerning the blessing and restoration of Israel to the promised land are spiritualized and allegorized into promises of God's blessings for the church. Now, there certainly are many allegories and many types in the Old Testament that can be applied in principle for New Testament believers. But both Old and New Testament are very clear about God's intent in bringing about a spiritual awakening for the nation of Israel as they are made to embrace Jesus, their Messiah, which will then usher into the 1,000-year reign of Christ on the earth. I'm not going to go any further than just to say that. So replacement theology is bad theology. It's not biblical theology. Now we move on to the next section, verse 35. We're going to read 35 down to 37. Thus says the Lord, who gives the sun for light by day, and the fixed order of the moon and the stars for light by night, who stirs up the sea so that its waves roar. The Lord of hosts is his name. If this fixed order departs from me, declares the Lord, then the offspring of Israel also will cease from being a nation before me forever. Thus says the Lord, if the heavens above can be measured and the foundations of the earth searched out below, then I also will cast off all of the offspring of Israel for all that they have done, declares the Lord. And this really comes in on the heels of what we just read in verses 31 through 34. To underscore Israel's permanence because of this new covenant, God compared her existence to that of the heavens and the earth. As God had appointed the sun to shine by day and the moon and stars to shine by night, so he had appointed Israel as his chosen nation. It would take a feat as fabulous as making these natural decrees vanish from nature to make Israel cease to be a nation. The power that God displayed in creating the universe as the power was the power that he exercises in preserving Israel as a nation. Throughout history, people have tried in vain to destroy Israel, but none have succeeded completely, and none ever will. The survival of Israel through the centuries can be explained only on supernatural grounds. Scripture knows no greater guarantee for the validity and permanence of the covenant than what is stated here in the text we just read. The concept of nation carries with it geographical location, government, and other ethnic features to be fully realized in the end time. National existence is assured regardless of how God may have to deal with the individuals in the nation. God regards his promises rather than their demerits. So it's an amazing thing that God is going to do, especially if you were to be living in the time of Moses, when Moses and Aaron both were forbidden from going into the promised land, and all you really had was Caleb and Joshua. You would have thought at that point, Israel's gone, man. You got two people representing them. They're out of here. And yet, here we are getting a promise like this. Moving on into verse 38. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when the city will be rebuilt for the Lord from the tower of Hananel to the corner gate. The measuring line will go out farther straight ahead to the hill Gareb, and then it will turn to Goa. And the whole valley of the dead bodies and of the ashes and all the fields as far as the brook Kidron to the corner of the horse gate toward the east shall be holy to the Lord. It will not be plucked up or overthrown anymore forever. Earlier, God had said Jerusalem would be destroyed. Here he said it would be rebuilt. The various locations named in these verses probably are intended to mark the limits of the city. The Tower of Hananel was a tower in the north wall of the city, and it was mentioned, Nehemiah, both Nehemiah and Zechariah. The corner gate was located at the northwest corner of the city. In verse 39, Gareb and Goa, are otherwise unknown. Those names don't occur anywhere else in the Old Testament, so we don't know exactly where those places are. Parallel references to measuring in restoration context, you can find some in the book of Ezekiel. You'll find lots of measuring going on there. And you'll even find some measuring going on in the book of Zechariah. The imagery of measuring serves to emphasize the reality and certainty of the fulfillment. We don't need to take Ezekiel's measuring of the temple that's coming as being just figurative. There's going to be an actual temple. And Ezekiel was marking it out as he was directed by God. And then in verse 40, let me turn it real quick. Just as the people would experience purification, so also would the city. Uncleanness would even be removed from the valley where dead bodies and sacrificial ashes were thrown, and the city would be sanctified. Sacrificial ashes, probably the place, this is probably referring to the Valley of Hinnom, where they would burn things. The horse gate was located at the southeast end of the temple complex. In the fields of the Kidron Valley, this is where King Josiah had Hilkiah, the high priest, burn the objects of idolatry that were purged from the temple. So the point of verse 40 is that the defilement caused by Judah's sins would be reversed forever, and that consequently the city would never fall under the Lord's curse of destruction again. All the things that they had done to completely defile the land of Jerusalem, God is going to reverse all of that. The rebuilt city is to become the center of God's presence among his people and forever under his protection. The land was marked out from eternity past as God's land. Period. Now we move to chapter 32. We're going to zip through this pretty quickly. Jeremiah 32. Jeremiah's faith in the Lord's words of restoration in chapters 30 and 31 are now going to be put to the test. This chapter is important as showing the reality of Jeremiah's faith in the Lord's promises of the nation's restoration. The time was the second year of the siege of Jerusalem, about 588 or 587 BC. The siege had begun in Zedekiah's ninth year, but the Babylonians had withdrawn on hearing of the approach of the Egyptian army. Jerusalem fell in August of the following year, 586 BC. Now it's at this point in Jeremiah that a very long section of the book begins. In chronology, it's probably more cohesive than the preceding parts of the book. Some scholars place chapter 32 after chapters 37 and 38. Chapter 32 deals with what happened during the years before the capture of Jerusalem, the destruction of the city, and the incidents that immediately followed. It was indeed a very dark time. Jerusalem was undergoing its final siege, and Jeremiah himself, well, as we'll see here, was being incarcerated. Look at verse 1. Let's read verses 1 through 5. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord in the 10th year of Zedekiah, king of Judah, which was the 18th year of Nebuchadnezzar. Now at that time, the army of the king of Babylon was besieging Jerusalem, and Jeremiah the prophet was shut up in the court of the guard, which is in the house of the king of Judah. Because Zedekiah, king of Judah, had shut him up, saying, why do you prophesy saying, thus says the Lord, behold, I am about to give this city into the hand of the king of Babylon, and he will take it. And Zedekiah, king of Judah, will not escape out of the hand of the Chaldeans, but he will surely be given into the hand of the king of Babylon, and he will speak with him face to face and see him eye to eye. And he will take Zedekiah to Babylon, and he will be there until I visit him, declares the Lord. If you fight against the Chaldeans, you will not succeed. Chaldeans being another name for the Babylonians. So here in our text, we're given another time marker in verse 1. And then we find out in verse 2, during the siege, Jeremiah was shut up. Now, it needs to be pointed out that the courtyard of the guard was a place where privileged prisoners were kept instead of being confined in a dungeon. And even though the reader knows that Jeremiah was a true prophet, the reason Jeremiah was incarcerated is because the people considered him to be a traitor for calling on them to surrender to the Babylonians. Zedekiah could not understand why Jeremiah would prophesy against the city and against the king. But, as we know, Jeremiah correctly predicted that Zedekiah would speak to Nebuchadnezzar face to face. He would see him eye to eye. He would be taken as a prisoner to Babylon, where Nebuchadnezzar was definitely going to be dealing with him, and we'll look at that later on. Continuing on in verse 6. Let me take a sip here, my mouth's dry. Verse 6 says, and Jeremiah said, the word of the Lord came to me. Behold, Hanamel, the son of Shallum, your uncle, is coming to you, saying, buy for yourself my field which is at Anathoth, for you have the right of redemption to buy it. Then Hanamel, my uncle's son, came to me in the court of the guard, according to the word of the Lord, and said to me, buy my field, please, that is at Anathoth, which is in the land of Benjamin, for you have the right of possession, and the redemption is yours. Buy it for yourself, period. Then, it says, then I knew, Jeremiah says, then I knew that this was the word of the Lord. So in verses 6 through 8, we have the account of Jeremiah's purchase of a field, which presents another symbolic act performed by the prophet. Now the interpretation is going to be given at the very end of the chapter. So here, during this grim time, God came to tell Jeremiah of an impending visit. Jeremiah's cousin, this guy Hanamel, son of Shallum, would visit Jeremiah in prison and ask him to buy this field at Anathoth. Hanamel here was actually following the Mosaic law, which called for a person to redeem or purchase the property of a relative who was forced to sell it so that it would not leave the family. So Hanamel told Jeremiah that it was his right and his duty to buy it. Now perhaps Hanamel, I don't know why that name is such a tongue twister for me, but perhaps Hanamel was trying to sell the land to obtain money for food because of the siege. The village of Anathoth was already under Babylonian control, and so this purchase would appear to be very foolish. Who would want to buy a parcel of land that had already fallen into enemy hands? Well, because of this apparent foolishness, God told Jeremiah in advance that Hanamel would come to Jeremiah so that Jeremiah would recognize that God's hand was in this request. So Jeremiah wouldn't be tempted to think, that's a bad bet. No thanks. See if there's another relative that can take it. So, verse 9, continuing on. So verse 9 says, I bought the field which was at Anathoth from Hanamel, my uncle's son, and I weighed out the silver for him, 17 shekels of silver. I signed and sealed the deed. I called in witnesses and weighed out the silver on the scales. Then I took the deeds of purchase, both the sealed copy containing the terms and conditions and the open copy. And I gave the deed of purchase to Baruch, the son of Neriah, the son of Maaseiah, in the sight of Hanamel, my uncle's son, and in the sight of the witnesses who signed the deed of purchase before all the Jews who were sitting in the court of the guard. And I commanded Baruch in their presence, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, take these deeds, this sealed deed of purchase and this open deed, and put them in an earthenware jar, that they may last a long time. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, houses and fields and vineyards will again be bought in this land. So you kind of see what's going on here. Hanamel came. Jeremiah bought the field for roughly 7 ounces of silver, according to the margin in the NIV. Following the legal customs of the day, Jeremiah signed and sealed the deed, had it witnessed before he paid Hanamel. 2 copies of the deed were purchased. One was sealed by being bound with a piece of string or a cord, and then having Jeremiah's official seal stamped into a lump of clay placed over the string. The other copy remained unsealed so that it could be later examined. Jeremiah handed both copies of the deed to Baruch, who was Jeremiah's scribe and friend. And then we get to verse 16. After I had given the deed of purchase to Baruch, the son of Neriah, then I prayed to the Lord, saying, ah, Lord God, behold, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and by your outstretched arm. Nothing is too difficult for you, who shows loving kindness to thousands, but repays the iniquity of fathers into the bosom of their children after them. O great and mighty God, the Lord of hosts is his name, great in counsel and mighty in deed, whose eyes are open to all the ways of the sons of men, giving to everyone according to his ways and according to the fruit of his deeds, who has set signs and wonders in the land of Egypt, and even to this day, both in Israel and among mankind, and you have made a name for yourself as it is this day. Now let's stop there for a moment. There's no doubt that Jeremiah's prayer is closely connected to this transaction. What God has done is sort of put Jeremiah out on a limb. I suppose it's proper to ask whether this little object lesson of Jeremiah purchasing the land was for Jeremiah or for everyone else who was looking on. Probably the answer is both. We see that Jeremiah's prayer begins by expressing what he already knows about the character of God. But Jeremiah is doing more than just reciting a creed. He knows from history, and he knows firsthand, that God is all-powerful. It's one thing to know that God is all-powerful because the Bible says that he is, or because you've been taught that. But it's quite another thing to experience it firsthand. Now, of course, if the Bible says that, then that should be enough for us to hold on to it. What God's people have experienced in the past is what gives God's people hope for what they experience in the future. If God's ever answered a prayer of yours, then you have good reason to believe that you can expect God to answer a prayer for you again. So I find it very fascinating that Jeremiah has been told to buy a parcel of land that, at least at this time, for all practical purposes, seems to be worthless. And yet, right after he purchases this land, he breaks out into this prayer. In fact, I love verses 18 and 19, or the tail end of verse 17, when he says, "Nothing is too difficult for you." He's expressing here what he knows about the character of God. He knows who created the heavens and the earth and who stretched out the expanse of the universe. Great in counsel, mighty indeed, whose eyes are open to all the ways of the sons of men. I mean, Lord, knowing everything I know about you, you got to have something up your sleeve. We move on to verse 21. He says, "You brought your people Israel out of the land of Egypt with signs and with wonders and with a strong hand and with an outstretched arm and with great terror. And you gave them this land, which you swore to your forefathers to give them, a land flowing with milk and honey. They came in and took possession of it, but they did not obey your voice or walk in your law. They have done nothing of all that you've commanded them to do. Therefore, you made all this calamity come upon them. Behold, the siege ramps have reached the city to take it, and the city is given into the hand of the Chaldeans who fight against it, because of the sword, the famine, and the pestilence. And what you have spoken has come to pass, and behold, you see it. You've said to me, O Lord God, buy for yourself the field with the money and call in witnesses, although the city is given into the hand of the Chaldeans." Now, we can see that with these words, Jeremiah is sort of hanging the idea out there that he would like to know where God is going with all of this. What God has essentially done is told Jeremiah to buy a stake in a parcel of land based upon a promise that is yet to be fulfilled. I wonder if any of us would think that this was a very good stock option. I mean, would we invest in a company that we found out went bankrupt, all the employees had to be let go, and then the building was destroyed by, let's say, an earthquake, and every consumer lost interest in the product, and the product now was no longer popular? How many of us would be jumping through hoops of fire to buy stock in that company? And the answer is no one would. So this doesn't seem like a very good bet. Nevertheless, and what Jeremiah is doing here in these verses is he's laying out the groundwork here. He's saying, yeah, I mean, Lord, I know what it says in Deuteronomy, and I know what it says in Numbers and Exodus, and I know about all the promises that Joshua was given about how we were going to take over this land. I understand historically why this land belonged, past tense, to us, but according to those stipulations under the Mosaic law, you said in Deuteronomy 28 that if this is what we would do, if we would sin against you, the land would be taken away. We'd lose the land. So I expect the land to be lost, and I don't expect any good to come out of the land. And so, what's up with buying the parcel of land? Does that make sense? You guys tracking with this? Verse 26. Then the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, saying, "Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is anything too difficult for me?" Now, we can stop right there. We could ponder those two verses, or at least verse 27, for about 2 hours. Is this really that hard to believe? Abraham with a barren wife giving birth to seed so innumerable it would exceed the count of all the sand of the sea or the stars in heaven. And these are the types of things that God presents to his people that just causes his people to say, but how? How? How can that happen? The God of all flesh, is anything too difficult for me? Continuing, verse 28. Thus says the Lord, behold, I am about to give this city into the hand of the Chaldeans and into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and he will take it. The Chaldeans who are burning against this city will enter and set this city on fire and burn it with the houses where people have offered incense to Baal on their roofs and poured out drink offerings to other gods to provoke me to anger. Indeed, the sons of Israel and the sons of Judah have been doing only evil in my sight from their youth. For the sons of Israel have been only provoking me to anger by the work of their hands, declares the Lord. Indeed, this city has been to me a provocation of my anger and my wrath from the day that they've built it even to this day, so that it should be removed from before my face. Because of all the evil of the sons of Israel and the sons of Judah, which they have done to provoke me to anger, they, their kings, their leaders, their priests, their prophets, the men of Judah, and the inhabitants of Jerusalem. And they've turned their back to me and not their face, even though I've taught them, teaching again and again that they would not listen and receive instruction. Does anybody here want to be that disobedient to God, by the way? Anyone want to be this disobedient? Where it's like just bang, 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 keeps knocking at the door and no one's home all the time? He continues, but they put their detestable things in the house, which is called by my name, to defile it. They built high places of Baal that are in the valley of Ben-Hinnom to cause their sons and their daughters to pass through the fire to Molech, which I had not commanded them, nor had it entered into my mind that they should do this abomination to cause Judah to sin. Now therefore, thus says the Lord God of Israel concerning the city of which you say it is given into the hand of the king of Babylon by sword, by famine, and by pestilence. Behold, I will gather them out of the lands to which I have driven them in my anger, in my wrath and in great indignation, and I will bring them back to this place and make them dwell in safety, and they will be my people and I will be their God, and I will give them one heart and one way that they may fear me always for their own good and for the good of their children after them. This goes back to that heart renewal. Put my law in their hearts. Pour out my spirit on them, God says in Ezekiel, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them that I will not turn away from them to do them good, and I will put the fear of me in their hearts so that they will not turn away from me. Do you ever pray that? Lord, please put your fear in me so that I will not turn away from you. There's nothing wrong with praying that prayer. I pray that prayer. Lord, put your fear in my heart. Do I only want to serve God because I'm afraid of him? Sure. I want to serve him because I love him, and I want to serve him because I'm afraid of hell. You have a problem with that? You should want to serve God because you're afraid of hell. There's nothing wrong with that. The fear of the Lord, and we serve him because we love him. It's both. It's not either or. Look at verse 41. I will rejoice over them to do them good and will faithfully plant them in this land with all my heart and with all my soul. So here we see the immutability of God's promise, that it cannot be thwarted. Verse 42. Thus says the Lord, just as I brought all this great disaster on this people, so I am going to bring on them all the good that I'm promising them. Fields will be bought in this land of which you say it is a desolation without man or beast. It is given into the hand of the Chaldeans. Men will buy fields for money, sign and seal deeds, and call in witnesses in the land of Benjamin, in the environs of Jerusalem, in the cities of Judah, in the cities of the hill country, in the cities of the lowland, in the cities of the Negev, which is the land of the south, down near the Dead Sea. For I will restore their fortunes, declares the Lord. God is saying, this is a great stock to invest in. because it's going to yield eternal dividends. So, yep, buy that piece of land. Proverbs 21:30 says, "There is no wisdom and no understanding and no counsel against the Lord." Proverbs 19:21 says, many plans are in man's heart. We make lots of plans. We have a lot of ideas about the future, but the counsel of the Lord will stand. Psalm 33:10 and 11 says this, "The Lord nullifies the counsel of the nations. He frustrates the plans of the peoples. The counsel of the Lord stands forever. The plans of his heart from generation to generation." If anyone's fighting against the Lord tonight, you'll always lose. He will fulfill his plan. And we either line up with his will and benefit as a beneficiary of lining up with his will, or his will bowl us right over and we will be consumed, because his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, faith requires great sacrifice on our part. We have to trust in God's word. We have to trust in what God says, even when all the powers of Satan and the influence of secular thought is arrayed against us, telling us that to trust God is foolish. Hebrews chapter 11 comes to mind when I think of what God is asking of Jeremiah. By faith, Jeremiah had to buy that parcel of land. It doesn't say that in Hebrews 11, but we could add it there, right? By faith, Jeremiah bought that parcel of land because God told him to, just like God told Abraham to sacrifice his only son, not telling him what he was going to do. Abraham had no clue that God was going to spare him at the last second. He just did it, just obeyed God. Jeremiah bought the parcel of land. Later God said, no, this is a good buy. And so too it is with us. Right now, we serve God by faith. 2 Peter, 1 and 2 Peter, the first chapter of 1 Peter, chapter of 2 Peter, read those little sections in there that talk about faith. And the part where it says that right now we serve the Lord and we don't see Jesus physically. We don't see God physically. We can't look up into the sky and see heaven. We walk by faith and not by sight. We're relying on his promise to carry us through. And it's the promise that we have of eternal life right now. That promise is what causes our hearts to be engaged in the work of God, to obey God, to want to be faithful to God. And you can read about that in 1 Peter chapter 1, how even though now we don't see him, we may even struggle at times to have the faith to see what faith should see, because we're going through manifold trials, temptations that challenge our faith, things that trip our world upside down and cause us to lose our vision for the word of God, and cause us to lose the vision for what God's called us to do, the obedience that God is calling us to embrace. We take our eyes off the instrument panel that helps us to fly when it's foggy, and the instrument panel is the word of God. Right now, sometimes all we have, sometimes, you know, we're praying and we go through dry spells where we don't even sense God's presence. You ever been through those? And you're solely relying on scripture verses. But that's still a part of how God builds us up in the faith. The word Jeremiah got, that word that he got was a sure word. And the Bible from Genesis to Revelation is the sure word for us. It's a sure word. What God says is going to be fulfilled will be fulfilled. what God says is going to happen is going to happen. And so God, by his Spirit, enables us to be quickened in our spirit, in our inner man, so that we can rise to the occasion to want to obey his word. But when we think about this promise that Jeremiah is being told to embrace, he was never going to experience the fullness of this in his lifetime. So that's what the faith chapter is all about. It's about people that continued to walk with God as Enoch did, even though there was nothing in the natural realm to prop up their faith. They were relying on a word. A word. That's it. This word right here. Amen? So that's where we'll stop for this evening. Let's stand. And that's why it's so important for us to read our Bibles and chew on the Bible. Well, you could do that, but I mean meditate on it. Think about the Word and just roll it around in your hearts and in your minds. It will change you from the inside out. It really will. And if any of you here tonight just aren't connecting with God in your Bible reading, if that's just something you constantly struggle with, I want to encourage you. Satan is the one that's causing that struggle to be magnified in your life, to do whatever he can to keep you out of this book. Anything he can do to disrupt us, to keep us out of his word, or to keep us out of God's word, he's going to do. Because he knows that this Bible is what feeds our souls and makes us strong spiritually and enables us to stand against the wiles of the devil. And so the Lord wants us to embrace his word, to get it into our lives, to get it into our hearts, get it into the mind, look at it with our eyes, listen to it with our ears if need be, whatever we need to do to immerse ourselves in it. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we just want to give you thanks tonight again for instructing us in what really are very simple truths. They're simple, but they're very profound. And they're very powerful. And we pray tonight, Lord, just as we saw Jeremiah just taking that step of faith against the odds and in obedience to you, did what you said, probably in the eyes of the world looking on, looked like a total fool. And yet, Lord, he was no fool at all to obey you. Lord, we pray that tonight we could just look at this example and be inspired by it. Inspired more than in just giving us a warm fuzzy in our stomach right now, but inspired in the way that we are transformed by this. That we're fired up for you, Lord God. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to take up your word, which tells us to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Lord, help us to be mighty men of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.